What's up? This is Ryan Hoppy, and this is Hoppy Hour. I am your host, hanging out with Todd Brandt from the Todd and Tyler Radio Empire. He is on Hoppy Hour. What's up, man?
Hey, thanks for having me. I think we've had a little... We're in this business we're in. It's proven the exchange we've had the past few days, what great communicators we really are.
I know. It's crazy. Like, I've always been this guy where I worry about how something's going to go. And then when things begin to, like, I don't want to say miscommunicate, but like when it's like, oh, let's do this time or that time, then all of a sudden I'm like, okay, I'm going to manifest a good interview. I don't know if that makes sense, because I'm a guy with my ADHD. I overthink everything. So like, I'm very happy to have you on the phone right now.
Well, yes, and I'm happy to be here, and I think we have a lot in common.
So, were you a guy growing up that always wanted to go into radio? Because there's different types of radio folks. There's people that kind of just got into the business, and then there's people that wanted to do it since day one.
No, I remember I must have been 11, 12 years old. I grew up in North Dakota, so I would sit in my basement in the winter, and I was able to get all these AM Chicago radio stations. This is how long ago this was. This was, you know, AM Top 40 was the big deal, and I would pull in all these radio stations from Chicago, Oklahoma City, Denver, and there were a particular number of guys that they just sounded like they were having a blast, and I thought, this is what I'd like to do for a job. I want their job. So, yeah, I've always aspired to do the radio thing.
Yeah, so I'm from Chicago, and I grew up listening to Eddie and Jobo, Mancow, Jonathan Brandmeier, Steve Dahl. I was born in 93, so I heard them on like the second half of their run, not the prime of the 80s, obviously. But yeah, Chicago radio meant a lot to me, and it's very cool. Who did you listen to? Like, was it like Larry Lujack?
Yep, it was the generation before. Larry Lujack and Tommy Edwards and Bob Surratt and John Records Landecker was a particularly big influence on me.
I had him on the show about 2 years ago because he was doing radio at WGN 720. And he's a really good dude. I've been to a few morning show boot camps, and he's one of those dudes where when you talk to him, you would never think that he's one of the all-time greats in radio. He's very humble.
No, he is. I've met him. In fact, we competed against each other when I worked in, I was in Cleveland for about a year in the late 80s, and he was, I was at the classic rock station. He was crosstown on the top 40 radio station, and we had occasion to run across each other once in a while.
Yeah, it's funny. Do you have any rivals right now in Omaha? Like, I know you guys crush it there, but is it ever weird when you see other people around town? Because in Tampa radio is demented, man. There's like just rivals everywhere. Like, I worked at 102.5 The Bone for 7 years, and I saw one of my old coworkers that does the afternoon show, and we talked for about 6 minutes, and both of us allegedly were on mushrooms we had it for dinner, not the fun type. Of course, it was mushrooms we had for dinner, and we both communicated that, and the conversation was all love for about 3 minutes, and then the second half was him pounding his chest about how big his audience was, and I was like, have a nice day, man. It was good seeing you. Now that's why I left the job. Do you ever have those moments where you see maybe a news reporter out and about? Because I know Omaha is not the biggest city. It's big. But do you ever see people out and about, and is it ever awkward?
No. Well, first of all, I don't get out that much. I mean, I'll go to a golf course, but I don't run across a lot of people in the business. And, I guess I used to get really super competitive and super defensive, but I've kind of gotten away from that since.
What do you think made you change from that?
Probably getting older, probably calming down, and probably realizing that, why don't I just control what I can control? But I do miss the competitive days of radio where, let's say it's a concert scene. Somebody presents, and then you slip the guy at the soundboard a few extra bucks, and you go steal the other radio station's position. You know, and we're back when, there weren't conglomerations. There were not clusters of radio stations. Every radio station was owned by a different individual or a different company.
So I got into radio in 2012, and you guys were one of my influences. I somehow found you guys online when I was in high school. I was just looking up radio shows because I grew up listening to Opie and Anthony. And getting into radio in 2012 was weird because there was a little bit of the Wild West that was left, like going to Tampa and working in Cleveland and in Chicago. But I would say, for better and for worse, the Me Too movement around 2017, 2018 is when things got a little more sensitive.
Yeah, I could agree with that. And I don't know that it's necessarily a bad thing. Funny is funny. People, how would George Carlin navigate the landscape today? Well, you know what? He would figure it out because he's a funny, smart, observational guy, or was in that case. And I think comedians can navigate all around the Me Too and the woke or whatever everybody wants to bitch about, but you can still be funny.
So on your show, you guys are very prominent on interviewing comedians, and I'm friends with a few of the comedians that you guys have had on. I'm friends with Chad Zumok and Jim Florentine. I haven't spoken to Jim in years, but like, he knows who I am, and he's always spoken well about you. When I worked for Mike Calta in Tampa, and Calta would always do this thing where he would ask about other radio shows, you guys were always one of the first to be mentioned as, oh, they're not one of the shows that makes us tell jokes ahead of time. They're super chill. How does that make you feel knowing that a lot of comics really respect you guys?
I love it. You know, I grew up admiring a lot of these guys. You know, was a big, big fan of Bobcat Goldthwait, and, you know, we've become friends ever since. Big fan of Lewis Black. And, you know, Lewis is now a personal friend. But we've always taken the approach, because I will hear, well, back when I was listening to other shows, I would hear people interview comedians, and they would always try to out-funny them.
Yeah.
And they would always try to get the last laugh in. And they would always try to bring out their character. And we thought, no, why don't we just talk to these guys, and we'll let them be funny, and if they get the last laugh or the big laughs, I don't care. It's coming out of my radio show.
Yeah.
You know, I think that they appreciate that they don't have to be the character, and they don't have to be on all the time, and they can just converse with us and be organically funny.
One of my friends that I met at the Morning Show Boot Camp is Brother Weez. And one time I was at the boot camp, Morning Show Boot Camp, and he said the funniest thing to me. He was talking about how he didn't get radio shows that get threatened by comedians. And he was like, well, because I'm the one that gets the bonus check every time I'm number one each quarter. And to me, that's one of the greatest things I've ever heard.
Yep, exactly. Our sentiment, exactly. If it's funny and it's coming out of a little speaker that says Todd and Tyler Radio Empire, well, who gets the credit? We do.
Now, you guys have obviously a lot of fans, and there's been times over the years whenever I'm in an Uber, because I live in Florida and it's a transplant area, I've had this maybe four times where it'll be someone from like Omaha or Nebraska, or I was on a cruise 8 years ago, and whenever people ask me about radio and I try to describe like my format, they always go, oh, sort of like TNT. How does that make you feel knowing that like, you guys are pretty much the face of Omaha radio over the last 30-plus years?
That we are the prototype for the talk show, when somebody brings up a talk show.
Yeah, out of Nebraska.
I just like that we're the industry standard. A couple of years ago, I got a trainer at the gym, and he asked me what I did. And yeah, I don't like to – some people aren't impressed, but I said, you know, I do a radio talk show. And he goes, oh, like Todd and Tyler? And I said, yeah, exactly like Todd and Tyler. that's the kind of show I do. So, yeah, I guess we've become the benchmark, at least in this market, because we've been here a long time.
Is it crazy to think that you guys basically, in a way, grew up in Omaha? Because a lot of radio shows will go to another city, flunk there, and then go back to the city they were in. But you guys were truly loyal to Omaha and the markets you're syndicated in.
Yeah, well, I spent a lot of years hopping around, and you couldn't have told me that you're going to end up staying in Omaha for 30-plus years. That would have just blown me away, because I would you know, go for a year, year and a half, and then bounce to a better job, and finally stopped in Omaha. And who would have figured? Certainly not me.
Has this job been everything you wanted it to be?
Oh, I'd probably like three times the pay. But as far as everything else goes, just the support from the community and our ability to, you know, kind of do it on our terms. Yeah, I guess I like that aspect of it.
Yeah, pay is always weird in radio because, like, you'll have friends that make more than you, and they'll say very elitist things. Like, I have a few friends that are in major markets, and they're like, oh, yeah, I just rented the 2024 Tesla. And I'm like, I'm driving a 2013 Honda Accord, you know? It's funny. It's funny, like, when you, like, know a lot of people on radio, like, do you have other friends in other markets, or are you pretty much just focused on your show? Because for me, I've reached out to so many people that I got friends in Seattle, LA. I'm always the guy that I like to get my name out there.
Yeah, I still have friends that I keep in touch with. One is, I guess he's no longer in the business, but yeah, there are people scattered throughout the country that I still consider good friends.
We don't
really talk a lot of radio.
Yeah, that's what I like about when I talk to people that are in radio, is that, like, sometimes you're so burnt out about talking about radio that, like, if you're hanging out with them, it's actually kind of an introvert's dream, because all you do is talk all day or hear talking from bosses or talking from other shows. That, like, here's an example. Whenever, like, there's this thing, do you know what Kava and Kratom is?
Kratom, is you smoke it?
No, it's like earth. It's like a plant that you drink. It kind of gives you a euphoric feeling.
Okay, I've heard of the Kava, but I don't know about the Kava and Kratom.
Don't Google it, because Big Pharma hates it because it's replacing medicine. It's not that bad. Anyway, I go to a lot of Kava and Kratom bars, and a lot of people will check out my show, and they'll be like, you're so different than when you're hanging out at these Kava and Kratom bars. And I'm like, yeah, because if I were to talk the way I talk on air, I'm not saying I'd get punched in the face, but I feel like a lot of people expect radio hosts, especially those that are in talk radio and rock and roll formats, to, like, just always be on. And, like, you're not lifting weights. You're not, like, mowing lawns when you're working in radio. It's not like a physical labor job, but there is a lot of the mental physicalness of, like, talking all day, you know?
Yeah. I mean, once I'm done with the show, I can go the rest of the day without talking. I don't feel the need to run my mouth the whole time, and I think it's time. That's the time for input, you know? You got to observe and read and look at things and watch things and shut up for a little while, and then run your mouth the next morning.
What are some things you watch? Like, do you watch documentaries? What is Todd doing his free time when watching TV?
Oh, a little bit of everything. Of course, sports. I will watch the shows I watch on a regular basis would be Pardon the Interruption on ESPN. Jeopardy. I try to watch Jeopardy every day. And then if there's a good drama, or, yeah, lately I've been kind of binging the Academy Award winning films, the ones that I could find on my streaming services. And, yeah, whatever a cool drama might be, we're into the Apple series Palm Royale with Kristen Wiig right now. And Succession on Max. Trying to figure out what we just finished up. But we always have to, the wife and I like to have something going, something to look at almost every night. And a lot of sports, I'll look at a lot of sports. If there's just want the TV on for background, that's usually the default mode.
What are your sports teams? For me, it's I like NBA, I like NFL, and ever since the Cubs won the World Series, I sort of lost my interest in baseball, because that was the greatest thing I ever saw, and nothing has compared since then.
16, 17?
Yeah, in 2016, when the Cubs won, I cried for about a minute, and then I said, okay, that's enough tears.
Yeah, well, I've known any number of Cub fans who, that was the pinnacle, and it's been a letdown ever since. But for me, growing up in North Dakota, it was the Minnesota teams. You know, I'm young enough that there was baseball was the number one sport when I was a kid. You know, so I've always been a Twins fan, although I don't follow them as much anymore. But Vikings all the way, and I attended Arizona State for a minute, so that's my college team.
How hard is it being a Vikings fan? Being a Bears fan, I'm like a divorced Bears fan because I haven't lived in Chicago in 10 years, and ever since that Cody Parkey double doink, I just kind of gave up on the team. I didn't watch one full game with Justin Fields. I might have watched 20 minutes altogether. I just don't really care about the Bears anymore, but I've always had a soft spot for the Vikings because I've always felt like, I don't know, you guys have had moments where you're good, but I've always had this soft spot for you guys and the Lions. The Packers is the team I really hate.
I'm right with you. Another thing we have in common, we could all hate the Packers.
Yeah, and I mean, I don't even know if I hated Aaron Rodgers when he played. I just hated when he was good because he would always expose the Bears. But man, like, I'm not a big conspiracy theory guy. I think life is actually pretty boring, and I don't think a lot of what Aaron says is really logical. I don't think it's true. What do you think about when Aaron Rodgers goes on Pat McAfee, or I think he went on Joe Rogan, and says all these crazy things?
Oh, he's always got to be the smartest guy in the room. And he's just a preening dick who wants all kinds of attention. And since he wasn't playing football at the time, he needed, look at me, look at me, look at me. I've never personally liked the guy. He's always rubbed me the wrong way. And, you know, when he beats the Vikings and, I didn't mind when he beat the Bears so much. But great quarterback, but not a good human being. Not a good human.
To me, I equate watching him to when LeBron James was on the Heat and on the Cavaliers, and he would just crush the Bulls. And there's just that feeling where even if the Bears or the Bulls are up at halftime, you just know that greatness is going to win. But Aaron Rodgers, to me, always had that weird thing where he was great in the regular season. Like, even when he won the Super Bowl, Todd, he got so many breaks. Like, Jay Cutler didn't want to go back into the game, and then Big Ben didn't have the best game in the Super Bowl. And I've always said, like, look at what Aaron Rodgers has done since that Super Bowl 13 years ago. He's done nothing.
No, he's been pretty flat, now that you think about it.
It's the unspoken thing, because you see Brady, you see everybody else. I mean, like, I feel like even Drew Brees, even though he didn't go to another Super Bowl, I feel like he was even better than Aaron. I don't know. Aaron just always annoyed me. And the other thing was, growing up in Chicago, everybody in my high school would be like, oh, Jay Cutler is going to be better than Aaron Rodgers. And then you would have people that were from Wisconsin, because Chicago is not that far from Wisconsin. And it was just a headache. I feel like the Packers is the reason why I hate the Bears, man. I just can't do it.
I see what you're saying.
Another thing. Go on.
Hate the Packers. Just keep hating the Packers. And I'll hate them along with you.
Now, were you watching the Minnesota Twins when they won the World Series years ago?
91?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes, I was.
How fun was that for you?
That was, it's the only time any of my teams has won a title.
Yeah.
So I guess it was pretty good, although I recall being unemployed at the time, so that put a damper on things.
Yeah, it's always weird whenever there's fun things that go on while you're unemployed. Like, I was unemployed for about 2 months back in September through November until I got my current job. And, like, it's always weird when you're unemployed because you can be out at the most fun party or have some really good news happen to your friends, but then you go to bed at night and you're like, I'm unemployed.
Yeah, you'll reflect back on it and say, oh, that was when I was unemployed.
Yeah, like, for example, I went to this party and I dressed up as Hugh Hefner and I won like $100 and everybody was like, oh my God, is that the best outfit? And it was one of the coolest moments ever. And I remember I was going back to my apartment in an Uber. I was just a little drunk, not too drunk. And I remember I'm like, I don't have a job. It's the weirdest feeling.
But you got the Hefner outfit.
Oh, yeah, and everybody was, like, dressing up as Batman, and I had a girl quit talking to me on a dating app because she's like, he's a creep, and I think you're a creep because you dressed up as him. I'm like, people dress up as Jeffrey Dahmer. Like, it's Halloween.
Oh, well, possible that she read you right.
One thing I want to ask you is when it comes to the Radio Hall of Fame, I love asking radio people this. When it comes to the Radio Hall of Fame, there's some people that really want to get into it. Like, I know you guys made it into the Nebraska Radio Hall of Fame. Has there ever been any talks about you guys making it into the National Radio Hall of Fame?
Oh, I've got no phone calls, and I have no expectations. If it happens, great, but that's totally out of my hands. I got nothing to say about that. Unless there's a way to campaign for it, and I don't want to go about it that way.
Yeah, there have been people that have campaigned for it, and it just looks kind of silly when they have like a hashtag and they're like, vote for me, vote for me. It's like you'd rather be elected naturally. I definitely think you guys deserve a spot, though.
Well, I certainly appreciate that. I don't know if we're nationally prominent enough, but thank you.
I would say there are worse shows that have made it in, so you guys definitely deserve it. One thing I want to ask you, how much prep do you guys do for the show? Because there's some people that will do prep all day long, and then there's radio shows that the show begins at 6, and they walk in right at 5:58. So, like, how much prep do you guys do?
I am all the time. I mean, anything that comes into my brain could come out over the air. So when I'm reading, I'm taking notes all the time. When I'm watching TV, I'm taking notes all the time. And if I don't have a pad by me, I try to jot something down on my phone or hope I can file it in my head and remember. But it's one of those things where you're constantly observing. You know, even when I'm on vacation, something comes into my head, I'll make a few notes. I'll jot it down. I'll email off a story on a text chain to the guys. So it's a continuous process.
Now, I love asking people in radio this question whenever I have somebody on the podcast. What is your commercial break process like? Because I've worked on shows where the whole thing was save it for the air and you weren't allowed to talk to the host. And then I've worked on shows where there's almost too much talking during the commercial break. And I feel like it would be better to save it for the air. So for you guys, what do you guys do during the commercial breaks?
Nick and I usually go out and smoke, although I'm trying to cut down on that. But yeah, sometimes if we start getting into something like that, a conversation, and we catch, hey, that let's say we have a guest in, a comedian, what have you, and that story's pretty interesting, and we'll stop, save it for the air. You know, if there's any indication that, oh, hey, this sounds kind of interesting, stop, save that for the air. So, and if it's a boring conversation, well, we'll just keep on going and not save it for the air.
No.
But yeah, the save it for the air stuff comes when, this sounds like it might be interesting, or, would there be a continuation of the last segment, so save it. So I guess that's we select based on what we've observed during the break.
Now, when you guys have comedians on, has there ever been a time, you don't have to say a name, where it began awful and you weren't getting good vibes, but you guys kept being yourself and then you sort of won the person over in the end?
Wow. I'm trying to think. We won some. Boy, nothing's coming to mind. A rough start.
Yeah, like maybe like, maybe they were just kind of in a bad mood and you were kind of getting off vibes, but then you guys sort of showed them that you guys are a laid back show. And then in the end, it was great radio.
No, I can't think of a specific example of that. I can think of any number of examples where it got off the rails from the start and didn't last very long.
When that goes on, do you and your co-host look at each other like, we got to get this guy out of here? Or do you guys sort of embrace the madness?
Both. we'll ride it for a minute, and then we'll look at each other, and Tyler and I will kind of say, okay, I guess it's time to bail. You know, and then one of us will get us out of the conversation.
How much do you and him hang out outside the show? There's some shows that don't talk at all to their co-hosts, and then there's some shows that are like buddy-buddy.
Yeah, but we're still very good friends. But, he's got his life and his kids, and I've got my thing going on. So we don't hang out as much as we used to at first. Yeah, he was a single guy, and I was acting like a single guy, and we hung out together all the time.
How did you meet him?
Oh, I was thrown into a morning show at the radio station he was working at in Pennsylvania. He was afternoons at the time. And I was put together with a husband and wife morning show.
Ugh.
And then about, maybe we were 7-8 months into that, they took the program director aside, who was one of my co-hosts, and said, you got to fire your wife and move to afternoons, and we're going to put Todd and Tyler together. So that's how that happened. I don't know her whereabouts. I believe he is now a minister of some kind. And Tyler's hanging out with me every morning.
What was the first few years of your show like?
Oh, haphazard. Here's what I do remember, though, is the chemistry was there immediately. Because I believe that's something that you really can't manufacture. I've heard, you know, seen and heard about too many shows that, we'll give these guys a few months. Well, if it's not happening within at least the first couple of weeks, then it's probably time to move on and find something that where the chemicals work.
Was there a moment early on, like maybe a show moment or an interview early on where you guys were like, man, this is magic?
There wasn't any particular moment, but I just remember us being able to pause and converse.
Yeah.
You know, and kind of, we adjusted to each other's styles so seamlessly that, you know, it just clicked. But I don't recall a particular moment where I said, this is going to work, but, you know, the vibe was there from the beginning.
Now, do you listen to any current radio shows or podcasts, or once you're done with the show, do you try to turn off radio?
I try to turn off the radio. I mean, I would listen to Howard Stern for brief periods of time, but then I was afraid his content would influence mine.
Yeah, yeah, I feel that.
You know, I think he's great. He's legendary, obviously, but I try to stay away just for that reason. You know, I don't want other radio people getting into my psyche, even my subconscious, or yeah, just being accused of ripping him off or someone off. So that's an easy way to avoid that.
That's like the go-to thing whenever somebody writes like a hit piece about a quote-unquote shock jock or outspoken person. Like back in the day, everybody was like, Opie and Anthony are ripoffs of Howard Stern, even though their show wasn't really similar. I've always noticed that. I've had people compare me to that where they're like, oh, you're so outspoken, or you're just ripping off Howard. And to me, I feel like it's sort of flattering because he's one of the biggest shows ever, if not the biggest. But I also think it's like low-hanging fruit. It's just like saying to a guy that has an edgy TV show, oh, you're like Jerry Springer, you know?
Yeah, yeah, and it's because that's the only prominent radio personality they could think of. they don't have a whole roster of shows they can pull from. You are either trying to be Howard Stern or Rush Limbaugh.
Now, how much did the show change? Because I've heard from all these radio people that after the nip slip with Janet Jackson, that everybody had to change their show. How much did your show change after Janet Jackson's nip slip?
I guess we were a little more conscious of what was being said, and the bosses were certainly a little more conscious of what was being said. So I still to this day don't know the rules. So I guess we would err on the side of caution, or be encouraged to err on the side of caution. Yeah, when it came to some borderline, some of the racier, edgier stuff.
I know that a lot of radio hosts, especially in the 90s when their kids were young, they wouldn't let their kids listen to their show because of their content. Did you ever try to, I don't want to say hide the show from your kids, but did you ever like tell them not to listen, or did you not really enforce that?
No, I don't recall ever having that conversation with any of my kids because I don't think they were really interested in listening in the first place. Until my son's got to be old enough.
I've heard a lot from radio people that like they have this cool job and they have all these fans, but the kids just view them as dad or mom.
Right. Yeah. They're not impressed. They get their fill of dad every day.
Now, when it's all said and done, well, first of all, how much longer do you guys want to keep doing the show?
As long as someone wants to have us. As long as someone wants to listen, and as long as someone wants to pay us, then I'll do this for, yeah. So people invoke the R word every once in a while, and I'm like, yeah, retire and do what?
Yeah.
You know, I like this. And a guy can only golf and ski so much, so. And the thing I've always pointed out to guys that I talk to who are retired is the thing I would miss most about retirement is the money. I like the money coming in.
Yeah, it's definitely, especially with inflation, it's not like 30 years ago where I feel like the money would go by fast. And if you're having a cool job and you guys have so many listeners and so many comedians that love you, I don't see why not keep doing it, you know?
Yeah, I'll do it for as long as anyone will have me.
So let's say in 150 years, your show gets brought up. How do you want people to remember your show?
Wow. Well, I hope they thought it was fun, interesting, informative, insightful, just a respite from their day.
That to me is one of the coolest things about radio is a lot of times listeners are stuck in traffic or they're going through personal matters or they hate their job. And the radio show is like it sort of sidetracks them or not sidetracks them, but takes their mind off of life. And to me, that's the ultimate compliment any listener can give a radio host.
Yeah, the ultimate compliment that we get is, you know, I know so much about you guys, and I've listened to you for so long, and you've shared so much that, you know, I consider listening to you like I'm listening to a friend. And, you know, you really can't get much higher praise than that.
Now, for people that haven't checked out your show yet, how can they find your morning show?
We stream on TNTRadioEmpire.com. We have an app. Just search Todd and Tyler Radio Empire in your app store. And there's a podcast. It's available on all the podcast platforms. Todd and Tyler Radio Empire.
Well, Todd, I know you're a very humble guy, but I just want to say I've been listening to you for more than a decade. I hated high school. I thought it was boring. And I would be in the library just sitting there, not really doing class. Like I had a typing class where you were allowed to use headphones and I would go back between you guys, Howard and Opie and Anthony. And the funny part was I was probably the only one that was listening to talk radio. So you guys would make me laugh out loud. And then everybody would look at me like, why are you laughing out loud? So if you would have told me 12, 13, 14 years ago that I would have you on my podcast, I would have thought that was super cool. So thank you so much for the time and keep up the good work, Todd.
Hey, let me ask you.
What's up?
Let me ask you, how did you find us?
I don't know. So I think it was on Wikipedia or something. Like, you know how there's different categories on like the bottom of Wikipedia, you know?
Sure.
I think I was looking up Opie and Anthony, or I somehow came across you guys around 2011. I forget how I found you guys. I think it was off of Google. And you guys were just different because at that time in Chicago, Brandmeier was off air, Mankow was off air, and there was really nobody. Eddie and Jobo were off air. All these shows I loved were off air, and I started listening to shows across the country because Chicago radio at that time, and even now, was not what it was when I was growing up. and it was you guys and Opie and Anthony, and I just loved the way you guys communicated with comedians, and you guys definitely had an influence on me loving comedy, because I just it just took my mind off of school. Like, I just hated being there. I always wanted to do radio. And you guys were just something different than the same hokey sports radio that dominated Chicago.
I'm sorry to ruin your perfectly executed out there, but I'm always curious because, you know, the show doesn't get marketed. None of the companies we've worked for have ever really marketed this show. I guess one did. But we always joke that the best way to find the show is by accident. So I guess I'll put you in that category as well.
Yeah, and I just remember you guys were just different, because most shows sound the same. They got the fake prank calls. They got this and that. And I just loved how you and your co-host and your team just talk, man. That was what I've always loved about it.
All right. Well, I appreciate it, and I appreciate you reaching out, giving me time to talk.
Yes, sir. Keep up the good work, Todd.
All right, well, talk to you soon. Keep in touch, Ryan. Thank you.
All right, bye.
Have a good day.
Happy hour. Happy hour. And like that, he's gone.